Okay, hi guys, and welcome to the show. You join me here at Gentry HQ, a little behind the scenes. You see all the lighting and everything. This is the main office. We just got some Gavox watches in, which I'll be reviewing hopefully next month. And also my poster from Oliver Harper, which brings me on to the subject of the intro. I just want to say a massive congrats to Oliver. He just surpassed 100,000 subscribers. Not only that, he's got a really cool Kickstarter project, a documentary he's making about action movies, I think of the 80s, maybe a little bit of the 90s or something like that. But anyway, guys, do check his channel out. Where is Oliver? There he is. And there's Duncan Casey's signature, and I think that's Richard there. So very, very cool indeed. Oh, and shout out to Duncan as well. Congrats on getting married. We'll catch up with him soon. If you're not familiar with Duncan from the James Bond live shows. So anyway, I just wanted to give a quick shout out. I'll leave a link to Oliver's channel in the description. Do check him out. He's one of my favorite YouTubers, without a shadow of doubt. And the irony is that I spend so much time doing this, I hardly get to enjoy any actual YouTube, but I always make an exception for Oliver. So congrats again, my friend. Anyway, let's roll the intro and get into today's video. Okay, hi guys, and welcome to the show. You join me on an absolutely gorgeous day here in New York. We have this Mediterranean style dry heat and clear blue skies. Yeah, so I'm gonna try and get a move on, and then I'm off to the beach with the friends and family, so can you blame me? Right, wristwatch check. Well, I'm wearing the Explorer, my dear old Fleming. I have put it on a brand new Polerouter strap. I will do a review on straps very, very soon. Yes, I know it is a faux pas wearing leather straps in the summer, but this Venezia from Polerouter, handmade in Italy, I actually really like the way this kind of distressed leather ages, especially with sweat. It kind of darkens and it gets this kind of texture that is unmistakable. Everyone has different preferences. That's just how I like my leather. Yeah, the Rolex Explorer, perfect all occasions watch. You guys know it's one of my, if not my favorite watch of all time. So wristwatch check done. What are we discussing today? Well, I thought a part two, if you remember my top five regrets of watches I bought, a few of the good gentry suggested I should do a top five watches I've sold, seller's remorse. I don't think there is a watch collector out there that hasn't at some point suffered from this, and if you haven't yet, you will. Things end. If we didn't experience loss, we wouldn't be able to appreciate having the things. It's the inevitable cycle of life, not to get too stoic and Marcus Aurelius on you. It makes us value what we have. Also, I have bought another watch. Of course I have. Can you blame me? This is actually quite an interesting story, so I'll unveil that at the end. We'll get to that in just a moment. I might as well announce it. It's probably in the title of the video anyway. Yes, I bought a Polerouter. Yeah, my first Genta watch. So we'll have a little look at that in a moment. Sorry, do excuse me. Number five. Well, it's got to be the Omega Speedmaster. I've owned so many versions. You guys know if you've been following the channel. Before I had the channel, I started off with the Professional, the Moonwatch, with the 1861. I was just getting into watches. A smidgen too big for me. I sold the Probe. I switched to the Reduce. First of all, I had the 351050. Then I upgraded to the 353950. That's the one with the sapphire, the slightly cleaner dial, less markings, the improved clasp. The movement's still the same. I forget the caliber, but you know that that modulated stacked movement with the crown slightly lower. 38mm size, the same as the first reduced. I loved them. And then the channel started, and if you might have seen actually my reduced in a few of my early videos. Then I upgraded again to the first Amiga in space, which was my first brand new Amiga watch. And you guys know my history with Amiga. I love that watch. I owned it for about a year. So back to manual wind, I just didn't wear it enough. And I think it kind of coincided with the Navi timer finally arriving. That basically killed it off. It just sat in the safe. And because I bought it from new, I kind of babied it. You guys know I'm all about wearing the watches. If it's sitting in the safe, it's not being enjoyed, why have it? So I sold it, I freed up some money, bought more watches, etc., etc. Obviously, I regretted a little bit, but I think the moral of this particular story, sometimes ownership, it's not actually about wearing, it's about this kind of funny thing where we want to tick boxes. Oh, I have to have a Speedmaster in the collection. It becomes about the possession of the item, not really enjoying it, which is just utterly ridiculous. So I sold, I basically sold it. If you remember, I did whole videos where I discussed, should I sell it, the typical thing. And I haven't really looked back. A few of you were quite shocked, especially because it's a gorgeous watch. The first Amiga in space is slightly a little bit more dressier, those alpha hands, 39mm in size. Then I got the Shumi, which is basically a limited edition Speedmaster reduced. I snagged it for an absolute bargain from Japan. It had that checkered flag racing dial, those beautiful red colors, a little bit like the Tintin, a nod to Ferrari, obviously. And being a big Schumacher fan, I used to go Formula One with my father when I was a kid. It was great to have. And then I sold it, obviously. Pretty much they all kept their value. These days, reduced are going through the roof. I mean, I remember when you could buy them for about $1,200, just over a grand. Now they're like twice as much. Actually, another lesson this really illustrates beautifully is that our tastes evolve as collectors. We grow out of things. It's not a bad thing. It's not, I will always adore the Speedmasters. They are, if not, I think in a poll they actually won against the Submariners being the most iconic watches of all time. More specifically, the Moon watches. But essentially, as we all know and I've discussed in numerous videos, they originally were racing watches. I even reviewed the 1957, the reissue from the Trio. I love that watch, but not enough to go back. I think I've outgrown it. And I think that's fine, guys. It's fine. Sometimes you can love a watch, you don't have to own it, you don't have to possess it. So yeah, there are moments where I see other people's wristwatch checks and I look at Amigas or I see my own photos and I kind of, you get that nostalgia and you kind of miss it, but not enough to actually go back. I've moved on. I'm a Navi timer guy, and so that's why it's only at number 5. Let's move on. Okay, number 4, very easy. It's the Squally 1521, the PVD blacked out version. I sold it because I originally had the blue, the Azzurro, then I sold that, bought the PVD, then I missed the Azzurro, I bought the Azzurro back, classic rebuy. I sold it because I thought it was ridiculous and too greedy owning two of exactly the same watch, just with a different finish, the PVD finish. The PVD finish, actually, interestingly enough, is done by Beretta, the Italian gun company. So it's the same finishing you get on the firearms. Very interesting. And it's impeccably done. I think it was part of the reasoning behind me lusting after the Cerakoted, my modded SKX. I subconsciously missed it. Looking back, I should have never sold it. It's fine owning more than one of the same piece. If you really love it, why not? I think I just have this kind of chip on my shoulder about, I'm naturally quite frugal despite, my serious watch addiction and, don't be fooled by the Atlas Clock and all the rest of it. I am actually quite frugal, and I just thought it was a bit much. And this was still in the early days of the channel. Now my priority is different. I have a totally different collecting ideology. I want to be like DuckTales. DuckTales, But instead of swimming in gold and money, I want to be swimming in watches. You know, had I known the channel is going to be, it's not that successful. I mean, it's still tiny in the whole scheme of things. But had I known it would be taking such a large portion of my time and my life, I would have just kept it. Okay, number three. Well, you guys know it's coming. Yes, the Oris Aquis. It's an important watch because it was one of the earliest watches I reviewed on the channel. It was a Swiss piece that really opened my eyes to more affordable kind of mid-range, especially Oris in particular. Unlike anything out there, I was so impressed by the quality. It really opened my eyes to this price range, because before I had only had, you know, affordable Seikos and luxury watches, Seamasters, Submariners, etc. The blue was too big for me. I love that blue, but 43mm, it's 43, it's too big for me. I bought the 40mm, it was perfect. Then the Squale came along, Squale 1521. That kind of stole my heart, and the Oris sat on the sidelines, and it didn't get worn, and I sold it. Had I have known they were never gonna make the 40mm, now, I know, they've reissued, not reissued, that's the wrong term, they've released a 39mm now, but not in that grey. It's a very particular grey, very subdued, very subtle, with that tungsten brushed bezel. Oh, it's just, you know, why did I sell it? I mistakenly thought, oh, you know, they're gonna make these forever. No, I've seen them on the used market, they go for substantially more than the regular. What's the lesson with that one? I think not to take it for granted. Sometimes they're not gonna release them again. And to not rush into selling it, I think. I think that's the lesson. Okay, number two. This is a painful one. The Tudor Day Date, the Prince, with the linen dial. This is the reference 94613. It was my birth year watch, 1983, in that unusual 35mm size. It was two-tone with the gold fluted bezel. Yeah, I had that watch for over a year. I loved it to bits, and I sold it. I sold it. The main reason was I had to replace the crystal. I cracked the original acrylic crystal, replaced it with, I think I replaced it with sapphire. I did a video about it, I can't quite remember. No, actually, I replaced it with another acrylic. This is the reason. And that took so long to source the parts. Well done to Saltzman's for actually managing to track down this particular crystal, because it was slightly an odd reference. Most of the date days were 36mm. It kind of scared me. It put me off wearing the watch, which is utterly ridiculous. Then I sold it and I bought the slightly later, with a smooth bezel, sapphire, the very last generation of day dates that Tudor did before they revamped the whole brand and introduced it as the Glamour, or reintroduced it. I've since sold it, the newer version. There was a honeymoon period, but it didn't stick, didn't have that same 80s Bateman allure, you know, that two-tone thing. And it's so funny because at some degree they kind of played out, but I'm an 80s baby at the end of the day, and I see my wife wearing her two-tone Rolex with HS and I yearn for it. What a mistake. So I've learnt my lesson there. Sometimes, yes, there are better watches that you could have bought, later versions, but if it doesn't have the soul, have that feeling, have that connection, you know, especially that linen dial, it was so unique, and it being my birth year watch, 1983. What? I'm such an idiot. Such... What is my number one? It's a very unusual watch. It is the Casio Skywalker. It's a very interesting kind of racing or a digital watch, obviously, from I think the late 80s. I snagged one off the used market from Japan for $200. Now, there's two versions of this, exactly the same, but one has Skywalker written on it, and that is the rarer one. I didn't really wear it that much. I bought it because it was just so cool, so unusual. It's a very charming piece, very distinctive. I love the way the chronograph and the display, the increments of time are displayed in different colored LED sections. It's very, very cool, very retro. And I sold it actually to a member of the Gentry. Shout out to Mike B. I hope you're well, my friend. Really cool guy, very nice guy. And I can't remember when it was a while ago. I sold it for exactly the same as I bought it. I sometimes, I'm a bit funny like that. I find, this is my own issues, but I think trying to make money out of watches for me was he knew how much I paid for it because I said in the video, it's just a little bit, it just feels icky, kind of, you know, I buy a watch and then I put it in a video and I sell it for more. I know a lot of people, you know, watch sellers do that. That's not my style. So anyway, he got an absolute bargain and I'm glad it went to him. He absolutely loved it and I'm really, really happy about that. But of course, I regret selling it because it's just so unique. And I think there's a real sweet spot now in the vintage market with Casios, because as we go forward in time, more of the digital watches become vintage, finding good examples of them becomes more difficult. And it was the rarer Skywalker, you know, the name says it all. It's a watch that you could sit in the safe and it will just increase in value. Some of the watch snobs, they look down at digital watches, but look, they're a part of horological history. They're part of the evolution of watches too. I've done numerous videos about this kind of thing. And also for $200, I mean, it's not the biggest amount of money in the whole world. Was I really that hard up? Probably. Probably, I was probably desperate to bid on a watch. It actually, that reminds me, brings me onto this. So last time I was sitting here, I was showing you my Universal Geneve, the micro rotor. Well, I returned it, and I returned it for a very good reason, because I saw this. Before I rabbit on about how wonderful this watch is, let's change perspectives and look at the unboxing. Before I get into this, I'll do a very quick knife check. Old Leakey is back, the Kershaw Leak, designed by Ken Onion. Just make sure the safety catch is down. Love this knife. The Griptilian is, I almost scratched my watch then, is kind of my favorite now, but I still adore this watch. Freudian slip. I still adore this knife. So anyway, let's get into the first incision. So I'll do the drum roll in here. Well, I didn't really intend on buying this, but I just saw this deal, and I put a cheeky bid in. It was an auction, and I was expecting not to buy it, truthfully. And I won the bid. Funny enough, nobody bid it against me, so I got it for the price I wanted. I wouldn't pay any more. Oh, I see. Oh, you can see the little flash of gold. Little flash of gold. Oh, I'm having trouble getting in here. Oh, here we are. Oh. Wow. There we go. Yeah. It's a Gerald Genta designed. Oh, it's going already. Lovely strap. Let's have a look at the back. Look at the edges on that scalloped, the case back. It's not overly, you know, scratched up. The engraving. Just let's get it focused. Oh, beautiful. Still very nice detail. The gold plating on this looks incredibly good. And yeah, it's got that, it's pre-micro rotor. So it's got that very bizarre bumper movement. I have owned a bumper before. It was an Eterna, because I did that video of before and after the, because they introduced that famous rotor with the five bearings that is now their logo. Got the original crown, beautiful conditioner dial. Just looking at it now, there's some scratches here, there and everywhere, but that's fine. I'd rather have scratches than somebody try to polish this and ruin it. Really good shape. Look at those lugs. Gorgeous, very nice, great condition. great, great condition. This is remarkable considering this is before, this is the first generation. So this is 54, I'm guessing, 53, 54, something like that. Little scratch on the crystal, but I'm so happy. My first Genta designed watch. Okay, so it doesn't have the micro rotor, the prestigious micro rotor, but it is one of the early Polerouters, which is just phenomenal. Let's pop it on the wrist. I can't stop myself. I was a little bit trepidatious, but I think it's paying off. I think it's paying off. Let's put it on the wrist. I can't believe this is 34 millimeters. It's big. It feels a lot bigger than that. That peculiar bumper movement. I love the way the hour markers and that chapter ring kind of plays with the light. You know, the refractions and reflections and that applied Universal Geneve logo. I'm so happy. I'm absolutely chuffed to bits with that. Anyway, let's take it back to the studio and we'll give it 48 hours and see how it behaves. I think I did well. I mean, I'm not going to share exactly how much I spent, but it was not much more than the last Universal Geneve. And I couldn't afford a solid gold. I couldn't afford the micro rotor. For a Genta micro rotor, pole router, you're looking at $3,000-$4,000 easily. I spotted this for just a little bit over $1,000 and I put in a bid and I won. I didn't expect to win. So I sent the other watch back because it was still within 30 days. I had them both side by side and I thought, well, which would I rather have? I kind of took a step back, but took two steps forward, so to speak. This doesn't have the micro rotor. It isn't solid gold, but it is a Genta watch. It's the first generation. It is in immaculate condition, and it's gold-filled. I mistakenly said in the unboxing it's gold-plated. It's gold-filled. Gold-filled is a little bit better because the layer of gold is bonded to the base metal, and more resistant to wear than your typical gold plating. And I'm obsessed with Universal Geneve. I love them. I think Universal Geneve are the hottest brand right now on the used market. And I'll give you some reasons why. First of all, their heritage. I've discussed it, the famous people that have worn them, their in-house calibers, they were the first to collaborate with Genta. They're very much a watch connoisseur or watch enthusiasts brand. They don't have that mainstream appeal. You know, you look at Omega, you look at Tudor now, they're very much more out there. If you see a person wearing a UG, right, they were either given it by somebody with impeccable taste, perhaps they inherited it, or they're an enthusiast, they're into UG. There are so many obscure watches that people don't know about. I saw one with an amazing wooden dial made for Van Cleef and Arpels. They're Tiffany watches, they're stunning, very bizarre shaped watches. I also think they're dial work is incredible. Well, like you saw the one I had previous to this that I returned. Stunning. It was stunning. There's one on eBay that if I had the money, I'd buy it like immediately. It has this floral pattern. It's just so unique. Okay, I know it's not to everybody's taste, but it's a bit, for some reason, it reminds me of tapestries. Like, you know, when, like kind of thing you'd see in the Uffizi or perhaps the Met, you know, this kind of Renaissance floral pattern. It's very regal, has this kind of old world charm to it. Also, okay, the Polerouter, yes, they are the icon, the first Genta, but let's not forget the white shadow and the golden shadow that were also designed by Genta. Hugely overlooked, and you can get them with a micro rotor, which, interestingly enough, I have to say, the micro rotor was lovely and slender, but this with the bumper, with that very particular movement, it's quite slim as well. It kind of reminds you you've got it on, but the winding on this is buttery smooth, very satisfying, and I'm glad it's got the original crown. I even like the strap it came on. It's really, really cool. I think it complements that gold beautifully. So yeah, my obsession with Universal Geneve continues. I think ultimately I would love to find one with a micro rotor. perhaps stainless steel. Unfortunately, at the moment, I can't financially justify keeping both of them. I had to choose between one or the other. I do need to save money. I can't just spend willy-nilly. Please do share your biggest regrets when it comes to watches you've sold. Which do you have seller's remorse with? Love to hear your feedback. So please do share that in the comments. Thank you so much for watching. Please don't forget to like this video if you enjoyed it and found it useful. And as always, guys, I will catch you in the next one. Okay, guys, ciao.